Before we open God's word this morning, boys and girls, I came with a story for you, so please listen carefully. There was a little boy about your age. He didn't live here in Toronto. He lived in far-off India, not in one of the big, bustling cities of India. No, he lived way, way out in the countryside, in a little village surrounded by tropical grass that grew as high as a man and jungle. And in that little village, all the villagers knew that they had to be careful because in that grassland, in the jungle, there were leopards and tigers and Indian elephants, and a person has to beware of those creatures. One day, the boy of our story, Raj, wanted to go to visit his uncle and aunt who lived in another village. He would have to walk for about 4 hours to get to that other village. And he asked his dad and mom if he could go. And they said, okay, you can go, but be very careful. You know that there's dangers as you walk through that grassland and through the jungle. And when you get to that big ravine where you have to go across a bridge made of ropes, be careful, but you can go. And so, bright and early in the morning, off Raji went. And for the longest time, everything went just fine. He walked down that narrow path through the tall grass and into the jungle, when all of a sudden, he heard a noise. Boom, boom, boom. Loud stamping. And when he looked, there in the distance was a big Indian elephant, and that elephant was angry because there had been poachers in the area and the elephant had been attacked. The elephant was angry, and when he saw young Raji there, he thought that he was one of the poachers, and the elephant went after him. He started to charge with his big feet to trample Raji, and Raji ran as fast as he could, but he knew that there was no way that he could outrun a charging elephant. But then, suddenly, there was the big ravine, and the only way across it was on a bridge made of ropes. And so, as quickly and carefully as he could, Raji went across that bridge until he was safe on the other side. And when the charging elephant came, well, elephants are smart enough. He realized that there was no way he could go across a bridge of ropes. The elephant was on the one side, and Raji was safe on the other side. Safe on the other side. Boys and girls, all of us are walking down the path of life. And as we walk that path, there are dangers, troubles, and trials. At the end of this life, we must cross over to the other side. And for us Christians, we know that for us, for those of us who love Jesus, on the other side is the New Jerusalem, the city of God. But there's only one way to get there, boys and girls. There is one bridge from this world to the city of God, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ himself. We must trust in him, and he will see us safely over from this life to the life to come. Boys and girls, and all those who listen, put your trust in Jesus. And now let us open our Bibles to the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation. And I'm going to be reading chapter 7, a rather brief chapter. Revelation chapter 7. After this, I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds of the earth to prevent any wind from blowing on the land or on the sea or on any tree. Then I saw another angel coming up from the east, having the seal of the living God. He called out in a loud voice to the four angels who had been given power to harm the land and the sea, "Do not harm the land or the sea or the trees until we put a seal on the on the foreheads of the servants of our God." Then I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 from all the tribes of Israel. From the tribe of Judah, 12,000 were sealed. From the tribe of Reuben, 12,000. From the tribe of Gad, 12,000. From the tribe of Asher, 12,000. From the tribe of Naphtali, 12,000. From the tribe of Manasseh, 12,000. From the tribe of Simeon, 12,000. From the tribe of Levi, 12,000. From the tribe of Issachar, 12,000. From the tribe of Zebulun, 12,000. From the tribe of Joseph, 12,000. From the tribe of Benjamin, 12,000. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they and where did they come from?" I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will spread his tent over them. Never again will they hunger, never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat upon them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." So far, this vision that the Holy Spirit gave to his servant John. I also want to call to your attention what is presented to us in the Heidelberg Catechism in Lord's Day 22, which reflects upon this particular topic. We read there, "How does the resurrection of the body comfort you?" And the answer, "Not only will my soul be taken immediately after this life to Christ its head, but also my very flesh, raised by the power of Christ, will be reunited with my soul and made like Christ's glorified body." And how does the article concerning life everlasting comfort you? "Even as I already now experience in my heart the beginning of eternal joy, so after this life I will have perfect blessedness, such as no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no heart has ever imagined, a blessedness in which to praise God eternally." And for our text this morning, the verses 14 and 15, where John says, "I answered, 'Sir, you know,' and he said, 'These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will spread his tent over them. Congregation of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, barbed wire, armed guards, watchtowers, vicious dogs, searchlights, a prisoner of war camp in the dark days of World War II, Allied servicemen held prisoner in bitter captivity, a scene of misery and frustration, a seemingly hopeless, desperate situation. But slowly, carefully, in utmost secret, a group of men were digging a tunnel under their barracks, under the fence, and out to freedom. It's the story of the Great Escape, a true story. A book was written about it, and a movie made of that book. Perhaps you've read the book, or many of us perhaps have seen the movie since it's been on TV numerous times. The Great Escape. The word conjures up a sense of dedicated purpose, of leadership, of sacrifice. It is in this good sense that we Christians can understand the resurrection of the dead and the life everlasting as indeed the great escape. How can we human beings escape the misery of being cut off from God? How can we escape the wrath of God, which is sure to fall upon a sinful and unrepentant world at the last day? How can we obtain the blessedness of eternal life and share in the glories of heaven? The Bible answers these questions. And our own Heidelberg Catechism reflects upon the biblical answer there in Lord's Day 22. In his word, the Lord God gives to us an understanding of his saving work. For the resurrection and the life everlasting are indeed God's work. They are the final steps in the Christian's journey as God the Holy Spirit leads us along through this life until at last we cross over into the world which is to come. The work of God, the Christian's journey, and the Christian's destination are all portrayed for us in the great vision given to the Apostle John in Revelation chapter 7. There we read of a multitude sealed by God. This multitude represents the people of God, Old Testament Israel, and the New Testament church, the 12 tribes of Israel, named there in the chapter, and also the 12 apostles of the church. Think of that, 12 times 12, 144, 1,000 times over. In verse 9, John is lifted up in his vision to get a glimpse of the life everlasting, of the church triumphant in heaven, where the people of God enjoy perfection and eternal joy. Here are believers who have escaped the misery and condemnation of a sinful world. They have escaped the temporary and have embraced the eternal. They have reached their destination, a place of refuge and rest, the city of God. And John saw them all gathered there before the throne of God, a numberless host from all the peoples and nations of the earth. and their voices were raised in a hymn of praise to God. The elder explained to the Apostle John just who these people are and how they got where they were and what their purpose was. And our text tells us three things about them and about what we hope to share in through the saving power of Jesus Christ. First, coming out of the great tribulation. Secondly, washing the robes and making them white in the blood of the Lamb. And thirdly, God's promise that his people will be before his throne and serve him forever. First then, coming out of the great tribulation. Those of you who have studied this particular topic of the end times may know that there are a whole host of different theories about this, particularly about the Great Tribulation. I can remember long ago when I was serving in Prince Edward Island, and I was driving home from a visit rather late at night. And in those days, cars only had an AM radio, at least my car only did, and I turned it on. And sometimes late at night, somehow, some way, the radio waves would bounce off the atmosphere, and you could pick up a station from far away. And that happened to me. And of all things, on this particular station that happened to suddenly come through my car radio, it was a preacher. And this preacher was saying, God will never let his children suffer through the great tribulation. He will rapture them. He will lift them up to Christ before the time of tribulation. Only sinners, only unbelievers will have to endure that time of suffering, which will mark the end of this present age. Now, perhaps in a way that might sound a bit comforting, but actually that is escapism. Escapism. The idea that, well, if you're a Christian, you're going to escape suffering. You're not going to have to suffer. You're not going to have to endure tribulation. And anyone who has read the Bible knows that God in his word certainly does not teach that. Rather, the Lord God is telling us here that his people have suffered through tribulation, through great tribulation, and they have emerged victorious. After all, in order to come out of something, in order to come through something, you have to be in it in the first place. We know then by the testimony of God's word and by our own personal experience as we live out our lives, that our earthly life is marked by struggle, persecution, temptation. There is much suffering in this world all around us and in our own hearts and in our own lives. How can we escape this misery? Only by the power of Jesus Christ. Our Savior promises that he will redeem us body and soul. Those who trust in Jesus will receive from him the strength needed to endure every trial of life. We will never be left in despair or sorrow forever. We will come out of the great tribulation. The hope of every Christian is that the weakness of our human flesh, our bodies, now often so racked by pain and subject to disease and death, will at last be made like Christ's glorified body. And our souls which here below must carry the weight of many disappointments and are stained with sin, and wet with many tears, will at last, be taken up to Christ and be free from every limitation to enjoy the perfection of life with God forever. That is our comfort. We shall be with Christ in life everlasting. The victory is ours. Christ has opened the way of escape. His people will come out of the great tribulation. And having done so, they will wash their robes and make them white. The struggle of the Christian in this life is not just external. There are internal struggles as well. We have to contend. Each one of us has to contend with the fact that we are sinners by nature. And by our own misdeeds, we have sinned against God and offended Him. We have made ourselves impure. Our robes are stained. Our sin cuts us off from true communion with God. They say misery loves company. Well, then we have plenty of company, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But how can we escape this misery? Our text tells us that God's people are those who have washed their robes. In the Bible, this is often used as a symbol for salvation. When our robes are washed, we are justified, made right with God by His grace. We know that Christ has removed the stain of sin from us. We are declared not guilty in the court of heaven. When we experience that, it's the beginning of eternal joy. Now we begin. Now we are at the start. And our hope is to share in what the saints above already have. Perfect joy, a cleansing so thorough and complete that never again will the shame of sin stain their robe. And the life everlasting belongs to those who have made their robes white in the blood of the Lamb. Years ago, because of problems with pollution, the government banned companies from putting phosphates in laundry detergent. Maybe some of you who are older remember that. And when they did that, people complained, our white shirts, our white sheets, they're no longer coming out of the wash as white as they used to, because there's no phosphates in the detergent anymore. Well, but of course, we have other stuff, bleach and various laundry additives that people use to make their clothes white and bright. But the ancient people had a far more difficult time of it. They didn't have Javex. They didn't have these laundry additives. The best they had was a natural product called Fuller's Earth, but it didn't work all that well, and it was very time-consuming to use it. So much so that when a Roman senator or some other government official would appear in public in a gleaming white toga, everyone knew that a lot of time and effort and trouble went into cleaning that garment. That, dear Christians, is a picture of our sanctification, of being made holy. Our robe of salvation is made white. How? By washing it in the blood of the Lamb. We are to keep ourselves pure. When we have been washed with Jesus' precious blood, our robe, our life is cleansed. It's made bright and white. And our earthly challenge, a challenge for you and me, is to keep it that way, to turn away from sin, to be separate, to be dedicated to God. And our expectation is that after this life in the perfection of heaven, our robe will be spotless, as white as snow, with no stain of sin at all. And then comes the promise of our text, to be before the throne and to serve God always. The elder revealed to John in this vision that those who endure, those who come out of the great tribulation, those who are justified in Christ and live a sanctified life, whose robe is washed and white, they will receive a rich blessing. They are before the throne of God. That is the promise referred to in question and answer 57 of our Heidelberg Catechism, when the answer says, "My soul, immediately after this life, shall be taken up to be with Christ its head." And how we need to hear those words. We know as a congregation, families in our midst have been touched by death. And all of us, as we think back, there's not one of us who have not been called to stand at the graveside of a loved one. That is sad, and tears fall. But the promise of God holds true. Those who leave this life in the faith of Jesus Christ, those who have loved their Lord and served him, will be immediately taken up to be with the Lord forever. Their faith has become sight. Theirs is a joy beyond description. And says our text, they serve God day and night in his temple. The life everlasting, dear Christians, is not sitting on some cloud strumming a harp endlessly. No. The life everlasting is an active life, a fulfilling life of service to our God. It is service in the most pure spiritual sense. John in our text in verse 15 compares it to the worship service that went on in God's Old Testament temple. In the life everlasting, God's people praise the Lord and worship him without ceasing. The Bible and our Reformed confessions, dear Christians, look at life and death very realistically. Our world is a scene of misery, of war and violence and hunger and poverty and frustration. And even here in peaceful and prosperous Canada, we look around ourselves and what do we see? People crazed with the love of money. People consumed with a lust for power, a desire for material things on which they set their hearts 100%. All around us, at home and abroad, we see humanity cut off from their maker by sin. And so many people, they have the attitude, "Oh, well, let's eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die." Because yes, over all hangs the specter of death and the sure approach of the day of judgment. In such a world, in such a situation, we need to hear and believe the gospel. We need to stake our stand upon the truth of our Christian faith and declare, I believe in the resurrection of the dead and the life everlasting. And who will be part of this great escape? Will you? Is it your heart's desire to come out of the great tribulation? To have your robe washed clean and bright, ready for the marriage feast of the Lamb, which Christ will celebrate with his church in the world to come? Then strengthen your faith in God. Put your trust in Jesus, and he will see you through this life all the way to the other side of Jordan, to the promised land. To the place where Jesus has gone to prepare a room for us. Wash your robe. In sincerity, turn to Christ Jesus for pardon of your sins. Make your robe white. Spend time. Sacrifice your earthly goods. Make that effort to live the dedicated, holy Christian life. And then, Christian, then look forward to God's promise that at the close of this life, as a faithful child of God, you will join that multitude before the throne of God, and you will join that everlasting service of worship and praise that goes on without interruption in the heavenly Jerusalem. Let that be your goal, and the comfort of Jesus will be yours. You will escape the misery of this sinful world and at last join the church triumphant above in the life everlasting with God forever. Amen. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you for your promise. That after all the struggles and tears of this earthly life, we, your people, we who believe in Jesus Christ, in whose hearts the Spirit has worked, we will join the saints above and share in the life everlasting. And at the last day when Jesus returns, our bodies too will be raised, and then body and soul complete. Washed clean in the blood of the Lamb, we will praise you and rejoice in your presence forever. O Spirit of God, work in our hearts that we may believe this and that it may comfort us and encourage us. We ask this for Jesus' sake. Amen.